Good morning and welcome to the 26th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received apologies from Ruth Maguire for this meeting, and Gordon MacDonald will be attending as her substitute. Our first item today is to ask Gordon MacDonald to declare any interest relevant to the committee's remit.
The only interest I need to declare, convener, is that my wife's a district nurse with NHS Lothian.
Thank you. The second item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 6 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. The next item on our agenda is the second session as part of our scrutiny of the Scottish Government's proposed Stage 2 amendments to the National Care Service Scotland Bill. And I welcome to the committee Fiona Davies, Chief Executive of NHS Highland and Board Chief Executive Lead, and Karen Reid, Chief Executive of NHS Education for Scotland and Board Chief Executive Lead, both representing NHS Board Chief Executives Group today. And we're also joined online by Julie Murray, Chief Officer of East Renfrewshire Health and Social Care Partnership, representing Health and Social Care Scotland. And we will move straight to questions. And Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, convener, and declare my register of interest as a practicing NHS GP. Good morning, panel. In the last session, we heard from the unions, and they said that they felt that this bill was unique in uniting most of Civic Scotland against it. How do you respond to those comments, and do you agree?
Thank you very much for the question. Rather than respond directly to the trade unions, I think it's an opportunity for us as representatives of the Board Chief Exec Group to set out that when the Independent Review of Adult Social Care was published, the Feely Report, as it was called, the Board Chief Execs were unanimous in support for the necessary change, improvement and indeed investment into adult social care. We recognise some of the comments that have been made in committee by the trade unions, and it's neither for chief execs to be for or against what's proposed in the bill, but hopefully during the course of this discussion we'll have the opportunity to set out where we are very much supportive of elements of the bill and areas where we are concerned. Thank you.
Anyone else like to respond?
Julie?
Could I respond? Apologies for not being there in person. I suppose I would like to also start by stressing that chief officers have been absolutely committed to using our quite unique experience in managing integrated health and social care services over a number of years to try and shape and influence the development of the National Care Services. And I think as chief officers, we were probably the most enthusiastic supporters of the Independent Review of Social Care and the subsequent proposals to develop a National Care Service as really a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to reform health and social care to create a really well-resourced and consistent arrangement for sport and services across Scotland. We do feel, however, that we've moved a bit further away from the aspirations of the Feely Report and that the amendments are probably unlikely to achieve the consistency that he promoted. And if you remember, he promoted a coherent and consistent social care model which would remove the current postcode lottery. The NCS was also intended to address some of the challenges around ambiguity, complexity, bureaucracy of the current system. However, I think we think there is a risk that the amendments proposed will increase that complexity. So I think we feel that there's probably a bit too much emphasis on the governance structures and scrutiny, and probably not enough on the importance of well-funded and well-managed integrated frontline services that help deliver good outcomes for the people who need support. So I think that would be my response to that.
Thank you. And we've seen COSLA deciding that they are no longer in favour of this bill. And with that being the case, it seems to me that this bill is dead in the water, given the lack of support from one of the most important partners of the bill. If we are to be believed, we haven't had COSLA in front of us yet, but if it is to believe that COSLA has indeed withdrawn its support from the bill and does not agree to it, do you as chief executives and chief officers believe that this bill can deliver its intentions, or do you agree that it is dead in the water?
Thank you. I suppose my response is that the chief executives and board chairs remain committed to working with our partners in government and in local government in coming up with the best solutions for the future of health and social care in Scotland. And as my colleague Julie and Karen have said, that we've been committed all the way through that, through dialogue and the tripartite and shared accountability arrangements. I don't think it's again for us to comment on the position of another organisation. We remain committed to taking forward these reforms. As Julie said, I think that once-in-a-lifetime opportunity is a great phrase. We really embrace that opportunity, and I think it's between Scottish Government and COSLA to work through whether there's compromise that can help them to find a collective way forward that will bring people back into the tripartite arrangement. The NHS remain a key partner in that and are committed to this process of reform in whatever form that takes through negotiation.
OK. So, Fiona, you know, you spoke just there about, and this will be a last question because I'm aware we're desperately tight for time, convener. You spoke just there about this being a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. But we also heard from Julie that this is not going to be achieving some of the stated aims and objectives, and it's not quite achieving what the Thiele report wanted it to. That was what Julie just said there. So do you feel that the bill, as is now set out for a second time, is going to deliver for health and social care, or social care, sorry, exactly what it intended to and what you would like it to?
So I think going back to the point that you actually made, the bill as it currently stands has got a very strong focus on governance at this moment in time. We haven't got to the amendments that would actually set out how the bill is going to meet the aspirations of Thiele. So board chief execs are very much supportive of the three key principles of Thiele, which was shifting the paradigm, strengthening the foundations, and indeed redesigning the system. So it's difficult to say anything further than, at the moment, perhaps understandably, because we all know that we need good, robust governance structures. That has taken away the conversation about how do we improve outcomes for people in our communities, right here, right now, because people require social care right here, right now. And actually, we need to shift back to that dialogue around how do we improve outcomes for people living in our local communities who require social care, not necessarily become embroiled in conversations about governance and structures. Thank you.
Thank you. Emma Harper has a supplementary.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you all. So just thinking about part of the aims of this National Care Service is looking at how do we improve like prevention of admission to hospital, how do we support reablement so that we end up improving delayed discharge, things like that. And I'm just thinking about how integration's supposed to work, and we've got an example is Ayrshire. So there's East Ayrshire, South Ayrshire, North Ayrshire. They're all under one health board, but it's three different local authorities. And one of them is absolutely amazing at reducing delayed discharge. So I'll name East Ayrshire. But the others are not so good. So wouldn't the aims of the bill help look at how East Ayrshire's doing really well, for instance, and the others are not or could do better, so that we can learn from all these other areas? Is that part of the intention of this bill?
So I think in terms of the intent of the bill is a matter for policy colleagues, but from a chief exec perspective, what we would say is there is certainly scope to look at how we see improvement across the country. So your example of the Ayrshires, then yes, certainly if something's working well in one area, why isn't it working well in another area? And that's certainly within scope of the bill. I guess there's a question there, what is it we need to change that is not already established in legislation under the Act in 2014 that is not actually enabling those changes and improvements to happen across the country? And I note your point about delayed discharge. We all know there is circa 2,000 people waiting in hospital to be discharged, but actually there's over 6,000 people waiting in the community for an assessment. And unless we look at both parts of the system, those who are in hospital and those who are in the community, we're not actually going to be able to fundamentally change the position around delayed discharge. Thank you.
Thanks. Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. My first question is to Karen, if I may. Karen, what do you understand as being the purpose of the proposed National Care Service Board, and to what extent would it support the shared accountability arrangements?
Thank you. So my understanding is that the National Care Service Board will be a national oversight board that will be able to hold local care boards to account in relation to performance, in relation to improvement, but also to be able to support local care boards around that improvement. So hopefully that answers your question. Thank you.
And the same question, Fiona, would you like me to read it again?
No, I suppose the only part that I would add is that my understanding is that the National Board will set strategy for social care in Scotland. So my understanding would have been very similar to my colleague with just that addition.
All right, thank you. And going back to Fiona. So Fiona, I note from your submission that NHS Board chairs and chief... Sorry, it's Karen's submission, not Fiona's submission. So I go back to Karen. Karen, I note from your submission that NHS Board chairs and chief executives have, and you said, substantial concerns about the focus on the creation of a new structural entity. Could you elaborate on that? Thank you.
Certainly, thank you. So I think my introductory remarks set out how much support there is for a National Care Service, so I want to restate that. Where we have concerns, and I'll just go through those if I may, so, and these are all in our submission, and it's a board chief exec, board chair submission. It's not my submission, just to be absolutely clear. So in terms of the national board, we recognise their own responsibilities as it's set out. We would have some concerns about how you would ensure that 22 independently legally constituted boards had representation on the National Care Service Board. We would also like to see more information about removal of members of the National Care Service Board, given that, from an NHS perspective, board members are appointed through the public appointment process. In terms of the National Care Service Board's role in relation to oversight and improvement, again, we would welcome clarity between the current escalation framework for NHS boards and indeed the support and improvement framework that is proposed for local care boards, so that we don't have duplication across the system. So I think those would be our key points around the National Care Service Board as such. There'll be other things I'm sure we'll touch upon this morning. Thank you.
Thank you. And Fiona, do you have any concerns about the creation of a new structural entity?
Well, as my colleague says, the submission is shared across all board chairs and chief executives. That was the nature of our submission. So I think Karen's probably laid out the position clearly in terms of that submission.
Thank you. And my next question, Fiona, it's a follow-up, really. So Health Secretary Neil Gray said at the weekend that NCS is about ensuring there are consistent standards across the country. Does the National Care Service Board, as currently drafted, achieve this in your view?
I think it's really hard to answer that in a straightforward way, because I think some of the challenges, as your colleague was just talking about, using the Ayrshires as an example, one of the variables that could be affecting why one area is doing well and another area isn't is the quality or delivery and leadership of the service in that area. But it's certainly not, in my experience, the only variable. So in areas like my own across Highland and Argyll and Bute, the availability of workforce has a significant impact on our ability to offer consistent services. So for the National Board to be able to influence that, they would need to set themselves strategy and policy that addressed the attractiveness of a career in social care and a way of appealing to young people in remote and rural areas to take on careers in social care. So I think it depends how the board set themselves up, what they will focus on, how they will prioritise the nature of the strategy, and that's all really still to come. So I think my position would be that a national board doesn't preclude that, but equally it wouldn't by itself without a lot of thoughtfulness and content necessarily create it either.
Thank you. And then the final question to Karen, if I may, is the submission highlights uncertainty around the impact of the National Care Service on primary and community care. So could you expand on those concerns? Thank you.
Yes, certainly. Thank you. So we know on the face of the bill, Section 54 from memory, that it's laid out quite clearly that primary care and community health remain the responsibility and therefore the accountability of NHS boards. What we would welcome is further clarity on the definition of community health, i.e. which services are going to sit under the auspices of the National Care Service Board as such and local care boards. You will be aware there's variability across the country at this moment in time. So clearly there is an opportunity there for us to gather evidence about what's working well in primary care and community health and actually where can we support improvement across the country. So it addresses the issue around consistency and variability. So that's where our concerns are coming from. We just need the clarity. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. The Law Society and other stakeholders have expressed concerns that the charter within the bill lacks legal status and overlaps with existing documents such as National Care Standards. In the opinion of the panel, how could the charter be strengthened to provide meaningful legal protections and ensure that it serves as a clear and enforceable pathway for service users to uphold their care and human rights?
Thank you. A couple of points in relation to the question. Whilst I think neither Fiona nor I are lawyers, so we can't comment on the Law Society's position, we recognise that there is scope to refresh the health and social care standards. It's been quite a few years, and in a previous role I was actually involved in developing the first set of health and social care standards. So there's certainly an opportunity there for the standards to be refreshed and for those to underpin the charter and effectively put the charter into practice. In relation to upholding the charter and indeed therefore the standards, I think there is an opportunity for us to look at how the scrutiny of health and social care enact those standards in practice. And again, referring back to my previous life, I think there's an opportunity there for the standards and the charter to be underpinned as part of the scrutiny and therefore the self-assessment regime that happens across health and care services in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. The reference to the charter in the bill remains that it's to be a charter of rights and responsibilities as in the Patient Rights Act. In the panel's opinion, for whom or what bodies should responsibilities be made explicit in the bill? I wonder if I could come back to Karen.
Thank you. So I think that in terms of rights, those who are commissioning and indeed providing services clearly have a key role in terms of making sure that the rights of individuals and indeed the rights of the workforce are taken into account as part of that process. So that will be health boards, it will be local health boards don't commission, but local authorities certainly do. So local authorities, health boards in our remit in terms of rights in association with healthcare, primary care, community healthcare, I should say. So I think there's a few things there for us, but equally so, those who are delivering services through commissioning also have to uphold the rights of individuals and indeed their workforce as part and parcel of service delivery. So a whole system approach.
That's great. Thanks very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to comment on that? No. Okay. Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks again, Convener. I've got a couple of questions on the creation of a National Social Work Agency and Chief Social Work Advisor. What would you think the purpose of a National Social Work Agency would be?
So I think for me, in simple terms, the promotion of social work as a profession, its training, the support and the oversight of it in terms of the key role that social work plays in our broader health and social care system, I think it would be there to champion that and to ensure that we have the right capacity, the right people with the right skills to undertake all the functions that social work require for us in Scotland for years to come.
Add to that, please. From a Board Chief Executive perspective, we are very supportive of the establishment of a National Social Work Agency. What we would say, however, is we would like to see parity of esteem with the 139,000 people employed in adult social care, so we see the same levels of investment in fair work and indeed in their education and training so that they can provide good quality care for people across Scotland. Thank you.
Chair, might I come in?
Yes, of course.
Thank you very much. Our Chief Officers Group is very supportive of the National Social Work Agency, and I think it will bring the profession much-needed parity of esteem with the NHS professions. We also would strongly suggest that it gives consideration to the wider social care workforce, without which social work really can't deliver. So that there is a national approach to workforce planning, workforce development, opportunities for people within the health and social care workforce. We do, however, think that there needs to be significant investment in social work and social care to bring about the change that is needed. Health and social care partnerships at the moment are having to make saving upon saving in social care just to balance our budgets. And at this rate, we're not sure how much will be left to move into a national care service, but we absolutely support the development of the National Social Work Agency as a critical, whatever happens in the future, I think that's going to be a really important thing to develop for us all.
Just to come back, Julie, about, and actually all of you probably, I've got the standards in social work education in front of me, and it talks about innovation, co-production, person-centred approach, empowering people, the standards of ethical principles like partnership participation, promoting full involvement of the people receiving the services. So in creating a national social work agency with an advisor in the lead position, would that enable then the creation of Scotland-wide standards for education and then parity and support, which is what Julie mentioned as well?
Thank you. It will certainly create those standards and hopefully the investment into social work. What we would like to see is the same parity in social care, because they're obviously very different professions. We'd like to see that same parity in investment in education and training in social care. We're very supportive of the Chief Social Work Advisor as part and parcel of the National Social Work Agency, but we also recognise we need to look at other roles such as the Chief Medical Officer, the Chief Nursing Officer, the Executive Directors of Nursing and AHP, who have a responsibility for nursing in care homes, the Directors of Allied Health Professions, who also have an important role in terms of providing social care and social work investment. Thank you.
So a social work agency would help support the other allied health professions or obviously work together?
Yes, we'd certainly welcome, again, more collaborative working across those key professions. And there is much of that happening, but we'd like to see that, again, continue and strengthen.
I don't know if Fiona was going to come in.
I think Julie does.
Julie, convener.
Julie?
Sorry, I think there are real opportunities. I think at the moment there are certain elements of the social work workforce that are very scarce, like mental health officers. So real opportunities for proper workforce planning and maybe some alignment of salary across the country, so people aren't moving across different partnerships and local authorities for higher rates of salary. I think it would really strengthen the training. Have a national training, and it would actually support our chief social work officers because they're quite lonely roles in councils and HSCPs. So I think it would be a really important development.
And I forgot to say that I'm a former nurse clinical educator for NHS Dumfries and Galloway, so I'm interested in the standards of education that would be delivered across the whole of Scotland.
Of course. I think you'll recognise that at the heart of integrated practice are multidisciplinary teams. And multidisciplinary teams, in my opinion, work at their best when they have confident individuals within each individual discipline within the multidisciplinary team. So each practitioner is confident in their standards, in their part of that contribution, but that it's then brought together. So having leadership across social work, our allied health professionals, nursing and our medical workforce is most likely to bring about effective, integrated, multidisciplinary working at the coalface with clients, with patients. And that's, to me, at the heart of making integration work.
OK, thank you.
And Tess White has a supplementary. No, OK. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Just wanted to ask about the overall impression that you have about the proposed Stage 2 amendments relating to monitoring and improvement of the National Care Service, and how might the proposals that change existing practice and monitoring improvement, given that a number of organisations and bodies that have been represented here already in this panel play a part in these areas?
Thank you. So I think I outlined earlier the chief execs would welcome further clarity on the monitoring and improvement process. We remain concerned that what we may end up with is a process where NHS boards may be escalated using the NHS escalation framework, and indeed duplication in terms of those local care boards around the support and improvement framework. I'm sure that there is a way forward in terms of clarity, but we haven't got to that point of working out exactly how the monitoring and performance and oversight is going to work. Similarly, I've outlined my concerns on behalf of the chief execs in relation to the national board oversight role, and I think we all recognise that the focus at the moment is very much on governance and structures, and that's necessary to underpin whatever a legislative body comes into play, should that be agreed by Parliament during the bill process. But nevertheless, we are being distracted at the moment from the real challenges and difficulties within both social care and health, and we welcome moving back into a focus on outcomes as outlined in the Feely report recommendations.
Mm. Just wanted to bring in Ms Murray, if she's got a point to make on that.
Well, it really just reinforcing Karen's point. I mean, if monitoring and improvement leads to better outcomes for people who need support in their families, then we'll support it. But I think for us, we're a little bit... We need to sort of get the relationships defined with the national improvement bodies like the Care Inspectorate and Health Improvement Scotland, so that there is clarity and no duplication or confusion of roles. We're also interested if a service has been deemed to fail through inadequate funding, what actions would the NCS board take and with whom? So I think just lots of questions are around that at the moment and not a lot of clarity. But certainly if it were to lead to better outcomes for people, we'd be supportive of it.
Mm. The marked up version of the bill, just to be clear, suggests that monitoring and improvement responsibilities would lie with the NCS board. Do you agree with that structure as proposed?
I suppose I'm
sorry, Julie.
Oh, sorry. Are you talking to me?
If you just wait a moment, Ms Murray, sorry.
Okay.
Thank you, Julie. So I think we'd like to have more detail about what does that actually mean in practice and where do the lines of accountability lie? So accountable officers of each 22 health boards would want to understand better what are they actually accountable for. If the National Care Service Board are therefore having that oversight and accountability. So I think we've just got to get clarity on where responsibilities lie to ensure that we don't have the duplication that Julie mentioned just a few moments ago. Thank you.
Okay. Have you any further comments to make on that point, Ms Murray?
Well, just to amplify, really, I mean, HSCPs are already accountable to IGBs and their subcommittees, to health boards and their subcommittees, to councils and their subcommittees. So it would just, unless there was significant streamlining of the process, it would add to an already very complicated reporting and accountability set of arrangements.
Okay, fair enough. We've been made aware as a committee that independent funding for social care research in Scotland is scarce, and that a tender to estimate levels of met and unmet need was not awarded by the government. What do you think the implications of this would be, particularly on strategic prioritisation for a national care service, workforce planning and establishing an improvement framework?
So I can't comment directly on the levels of investment in research, but what I can say is that we have an opportunity that we need to align population health needs across the country at locality level to workforce planning. And let me give you an example. Different areas across Scotland will have different needs depending on demographics. So you may have an area where there are lots of people over the age of 75 versus an area in the same local authority where you have some people under 40, perhaps migrant workers, different issues that require a different workforce. So if we got more effective strategic planning linked to population health data, that would help us plan our workforce more effectively and indeed address some of the health inequalities that we know pervade our society across Scotland. Thank you.
Can I ask how that is currently supported? I mean, strategic planning and ethical commissioning, what extent does the bill offer an opportunity to enhance and build on current support and learning mechanisms? Can you give us an insight as to how that currently operates?
I might be better deferring that question to Julie, given she's living with strategic planning every day. Thank you.
If you don't mind, Julie.
I think it's interesting because the section of the bill that talked about commissioning was really about procurement. And actually, I think commissioning is something quite different. And as Karen says, it's around needs assessment, but it's also around market shaping. It could be around economic development rather than just procurement. So I think to have all that data, that intelligence, the demographics, and as Fiona mentioned earlier, some of the real challenges in some of the remote and rural areas around workforce and care home capacity, for example, I think there is some real potential to do some national commissioning in its widest sense, using all that data and doing something about the very real challenges that prevent some areas from discharging people. I didn't quite hear the first bit of your question, so I'm not sure if I've answered that.
It was more just about how it's currently sort of supported. We're talking about that idea of study of unmet and met need, but how is the current sort of research in this area supported?
We can always do with more research. We can always do with more data. And we're working as a group of chief officers with colleagues across COSLA, SOLAS and Scottish Government around improving our data around unmet need. So I think we gather all the data we can. And I think the danger at the moment is the data that's easy to find are those around delayed discharge, and the unmet need in the community is less easy. So I think we're all working to build our data and our intelligence, because that will lead to better commissioning.
Thank you. I think there's a key point here, and perhaps I'm straddling into the economics of this, but we need to shift thought that spending on social care is a burden to spending on social care is an investment, both in our society and indeed our economy. And if I perhaps just give you some statistics. So a report from the Women's Budget Group in 2020 on care recovery from COVID found that investing in care would create 2.7 times as many jobs as the same investment in construction, 6.3 as many for women and 10% more for men. And if I maybe just come to something that was actually highlighted in the Feely report in terms of evidence base. So the contribution of adult social care to the Scottish economy extends beyond the care sector. For every pound spent on social care, more than £2 is generated in other sectors. And my final point is that it's not just about the investment in social care, it's the investment in social care generates social value. So we know that that contributes to the combined influence of emotional well-being, health maintenance, and indeed sustaining natural support and prevention. So I guess what I'm saying is social care both has a direct, indirect and extended impact across our society. Mm. Thank you.
It's very helpful. I also just wanted to ask about the ethical commissioning aspect. The face of the bill as amended removes that explicit reference. Do you think that's potentially going to undermine efforts to have ethical commissioning centred as part of the National Care Service?
So, as Julie was just outlining, the process of commissioning, and I'm a former chief officer as well, so I have some experience of undertaking the role that Julie's describing, requires a combination of understanding your context through data, through research. So if you like, a theoretical understanding and modelling of your area. But that has to be combined with what you know through listening to people, listening to partners who provide services alongside you in the third sector, our independent sector partners from Scottish Care, and also directly from people that use our services. And I think many integration joint boards and health and social care partnerships already adopt that approach because that's what strengthens and makes greatest capacity is utilising those relational alongside those theoretical and modelled understandings of what's going on in any given area. So I think a greater definition of what was meant by ethical commissioning would be something that would be welcomed, because I don't think anybody comes into health and social care to work outside of a framework that we would consider to be ethical. But I'll see if my colleagues want to add any further. Okay.
So just in addition to what Fiona has said, from a board chief exec's perspective, we would welcome seeing more focus on ethical commissioning, the definition as Fiona has just mentioned, but ethical commissioning that's focused on sustainable and indeed realistic funding models, and ethical commissioning that focuses on collaboration, person-centred care and enabling, not continuing that cycle of competition for many of our third sector organisations. Thank you.
And Julie, is that something you would concur with?
Oh, absolutely. We were actually quite concerned there was no real reference to ethical commissioning in the bill, because it was a real feature in the Feely report. And I think we'd, of course, be keen to work with our colleagues in other sectors to develop this further. I think it's really important. I think it's even more difficult to develop a collaborative approach with providers when funding is tight. You've got to have really good relationships and be very, very honest. So it's quite challenging at the moment. And so in terms of our collaborative commissioning work, I think there is much more we can do. As Karen says, it's got to be realistic in terms of the financial envelope. But I would like to develop that a lot further with colleagues in the third sector. Okay,
thank you very much.
Thank you. Karen Malkin.
Thank you, convener. I've got just a couple of sort of separate questions, if you like. Perhaps directly relate to one of the things that's been brought up by other panels is Anne's Law and where we are with that, and there's certainly an indication from other groups that we could move forward with this, you know, quickly. It's so important. I would just wonder what your views would be on that.
Yes, thank you. So going back to the question I was asked earlier about rights, from a board chief exec perspective, we firmly support Anne's Law because of the fact that it is about the rights of individuals. I don't think any of us today would want to be restricted from seeing our loved ones, our friends, our families. So we fully support the implementation at the earliest opportunity of Anne's Law. From an NHS perspective, we would also welcome consideration of parity in hospital visiting as well. Yeah. Thank you.
That was my next question. Would you agree across the board that the directors in NHS would welcome that?
Yes, that's part of our submission across all boards.
Great, that's great. Thank you. The other thing, and you touched a little bit on it, I'm interested just to know about Children's and Justice Services. In terms of your submission to that, is there anything else you would wish to say about where we go with that if the bill progresses?
So I think from a board chief exec perspective, we recognise the concerns that have been raised by our colleagues in local government. In terms of the arrangements across the country in relation to children's services, as you know, it's variable. CELSIS did some evidence gathering. If we go back to the question about research, they did some evidence gathering, and my understanding was that was inconclusive in terms of whether we should see a whole-scale shift to children's and justice services actually being within the National Care Service or not. So from a chief exec perspective, we'd welcome more evidence. Okay. So I think that's the position that we would want to take, is more evidence to actually help us make that decision. Clearly, where we talk about child health, I go back to my earlier point about the definition of community health in terms of delegation. And again, there's variation across the country. We would be concerned in some board areas that delegating child health would lead to fragmentation of other services. Quite often they sit within women, children and families. But I also know that that's not the case across every board. So the variability is there and comes back to the consistency question too.
Fiona, do you have anything to add?
No, thank you.
No. I've got one last question, possibly for Julie. Are you going to come in anyway? Well, I'll ask my question and then that might give you a chance. I suppose some of the evidence we've taken so far talks about how much could be done now. I just wonder if you feel that even if we progress the National Care Service Bill to the next stage, is there an urgency with some of the work that we should be doing now in Scotland?
Do you mind if I come in around the children? But first, I mean, we're a fairly broad church in chief officers. We've some different views, but the majority of us support maximum delegation. I come from a partnership with the children's social work and criminal justice integrated with the rest of our community health and social care services since 2006. And there are some real advantages, but chief officers are nothing if not flexible and creative and will work across any structure to make things happen. But I think there is a real urgency. Health and social care is a bit of a crisis just now. We are having to reduce care packages for quite vulnerable people. We're having to look at eligibility criteria. In my area, we've never really had to use that before. So I think there's some real urgency in terms of trying to fix, which is quite a broken system, and we need to devote our energies to that at the moment. And I would also add that any resourcing that's available should be devoted to frontline health and social care staff at this point. We're in deep water at the moment.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Before I ask my question, I'll put on record my register of interest. I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS. So I'd just be keen to know if there was any particular amendments or broad areas of focus that you'd like to see Scottish Government prioritise as the bill progresses. And I suppose it follows on a bit from what Karen Walken asked.
So thank you. In terms of the bill itself, I mentioned earlier it'd be really helpful to look at what is getting in our way of actually making significant progress now based on the existing legislation. So a piece of work around that. We would really like to see a few things, and we've touched upon those throughout the evidence session this morning. We absolutely need to strengthen our focus on prevention, getting it right for everyone or getting it right for every child in Scotland, and indeed improving population health and reducing inequalities. We'd also like to see a strengthening of work across broader public services, so working with colleagues, for example, in housing, around poverty issues, etc., drugs and alcohol, mental health. These are all within our gift, and certainly from a board chief executive, in every submission we've provided on the National Care Service, we've outlined very clearly that we welcome the opportunity for reform, but it has to be reform that leads to improvement in outcomes for people across Scotland. So I think there's some things, convener, that we can absolutely do now, and I know that we are working on that. It's not the case we're waiting for a bill, because actually, as I said earlier, people require health and social care right here, right now. They can't wait for years until we have a bill in place, an act in place that makes changes. We're all the architects of the system, and we need to create what that system looks like, not continue to be admirals of the existing one. Thank you.
Fiona, did you want to...
How do I follow that? I suppose for me, the focus on workforce is where I would personally feel, from my own context, is absolutely the priority. Colleagues may be aware that we've lost over 200 care home beds within Highland in the last 2 years, predominantly due to the availability of workforce in those homes and the cost of supplementary or agency staff making those homes not viable anymore to be delivered in the same way. Now, as Julie says, in health and social care, we're flexible people, we find solutions. But to be under that kind of strain where we're losing services in an unplanned and unstrategic way because of access to workforce and the attractiveness of social care as a career is highly problematic. But I suppose one of the other things that maybe I would highlight, because when we talk about social care, the word delayed discharge often comes in close proximity afterwards. But we have younger adults who need to thrive, who have disabilities. And the impact on them of not having available workforce now potentially is lifelong. And the limitation of those individuals to contribute to our economy through employment and to live their full life in social value, the phrase Karen used earlier, that's significant. So for me, this isn't just a challenge about a particular client group, which predominantly is older people who are in delay. We have to think about the impact of the availability of workforce across all of the different client groups at all ages and life stages who access social care to support their independence, to prevent further ill health or complications, and to maximise their contribution to society and their own rights as citizens. For me, that access to available workforce and therefore the career is really very urgent.
Karen, you wanted to come back
in? Yes, thank you. Just to pick up Fiona's point about workforce, I mentioned earlier we welcome parity of esteem for the 139,000 people employed in adult social care. But I do want to point out NHS Education for Scotland works very closely with the Scottish Social Services Council around how we educate and train the social care workforce. But currently, of that 139,000, we have a third of the 139,000 who currently have conditions on their registration and less time now to meet the conditions on their registration than what it will take to get the necessary qualifications. And I do think, building on Fiona's point, that is a significant risk for the adult social care sector here and now, not into the future. Thank you.
Can I just finish up with a specific question for yourself, Fiona, because obviously you work in NHS Highland. It's the only one who operates under a lead agency model as opposed to the rest of the country. Do you see that as being an advantage or a disadvantage in terms of having a health and social care workforce? Being able to fulfil all the functions that you need to fulfil. And I suppose I'm thinking here in terms of we're looking at this bill, trying to equalise the country. What challenges would that bring for Highland?
Thank you. So NHS Highland has also made a submission as part of this consultation process. And we've had broad dialogue across our board and our executive team in the formation of that submission. The view that we came to was that on balance, we are in favour of moving to a single model of integration in Scotland. It's a complex picture, but what probably the main factor is that not having peers impedes that process of improvement and learning that we've been talking about throughout the session. So we've got no other body that we can go and have a look at their homework, see how they've gone about it, how have they utilised the structures that exist within lead agency to maximise benefit and outcomes for people. So on balance, we feel that we are supportive of moving to a single model of integration as NHS Highland. That will come with significant challenge. I should note that within NHS Highland, of course, there are two integration schemes. Highland has the lead agency. Argyll and Bute operates within an IJB model. And I was chief officer in Argyll and Bute, so just so people have got that piece of context, which actually has maximum delegation. So we took completely extreme opposite models within One Health Board. And I would say in relation to the outcomes that our population experience, if we use delayed discharge as a simplistic metric, we're not seeing the scale of challenge in Argyll and Bute that we currently are in Highland. Mm-hmm. So I think that would also be in a factor that on balance, the board are supportive of moving to a single model of integration in the future.
Thank you. Can I thank all the witnesses for attending today? It's been very helpful in terms of the committee scrutiny of these amendments at stage two, and we'll briefly suspend to change panels. Thank you.
We now continue our scrutiny of the Scottish Government's proposed Stage 2 amendments to the National Care Service Scotland Bill with a second panel of witnesses. A welcome to the committee, Rosemary Agnew, Scottish Public Services Ombudsman, Marie Allison, Chief Executive of Scottish Social Care Services Council, the SSSC, Edith McIntosh, Deputy Chief Executive and Executive Director for Strategy and Improvement Care Inspectorate, and Robbie Pearson, Chief Executive, Health Improvement Scotland. And we'll move straight to questions, and Sandish Gohani.
Thank you, Convener, and just a register of interest as a practising NHS GP. Thank you for coming, panel. I have a number of questions surrounding the bill and how you feel this bill is going to improve the working lives of the people who work in care. So could I start by asking Edith, when you are going and inspecting and seeing what things are like now, what material change do you think that we will see after this bill passes, if it does indeed pass?
Thanks very much, and good morning, everybody, and thank you to the committee for the opportunity to come and give evidence today. The Care Inspectorate, as you'll know, focuses on outcomes for people. And when we are in inspecting, or when we are carrying out joint inspections with other organisations such as Healthcare Improvement Scotland, our focus is very much on what matters to people and how people are enabled to live life to the full. The social care sector workforce does an incredible job of supporting people experiencing care. And one point that I would make is the importance of that social care workforce being valued for the care that they provide. The intention of the bill is that services will be provided that are coordinated and that are of great quality, and that people are able to experience the care that they should experience and they get the outcomes that they would hope to get. Therefore, the intention of the bill is there that the workforce should be supported to provide that care, and we would hope that that would be what we would see.
So from your reading of the bill, Edith, as it stands right now, you are confident that this will improve the working lives of the people who work on the front line of care?
I think there is an intention for the bill to do that. We would hope...
Forgive me, Edith, I asked your reading of the bill as it is written right now. Is that what you think will happen?
As I say, I would just repeat that the intention of the bill is to do that. It certainly would be important for the workforce to be supported and to be recognised for the valuable work that they do.
I mean, that is a very non-committal answer, and that doesn't seem to suggest that you have confidence in the bill. So do correct me if I'm wrong. Do you have confidence in this bill to deliver exactly what you have just said?
So I have confidence in the intention of the bill.
Okay. But the stated intention of a bill and what is actually written could potentially be two very different things. But I will move on in the interest of time, as I'm not getting an answer on this. So if I could ask the rest of the panel, we have had in the last committee session, we have been told that this bill is unique in that it unites most of Civic Scotland against it. We are seeing reports that COSLA are no longer supporting the bill. Given these two very important factors and key partners, do you think the bill as it stands is dead in the water, or do you think that it is not?
Who'd like to start? Marie?
Yeah, I think, obviously Scottish Government will no doubt be having conversations with COSLA and looking at how to deal with some of the challenges that have arisen. Our perspective in terms of being the professional regulator of the workforce is we've been asked to look at the bill as it currently stands and to focus on where we think there are elements that we think would be beneficial to the workforce and where we think there are elements that could be improved.
I'm sorry, that didn't answer my question in any way.
I don't think it's for me in my role here today to say whether or not I think the bill is dead in the water. I think obviously we're at stage two and there is further work to do. So I think that's a matter for others to make a decision on.
Thank you. And would anyone else like to come in?
Robbie?
Thank you very much, Convener. In relation to the bill, it's obviously going through parliamentary process and scrutiny, and I think we have to acknowledge that point. coming back to Dr. Gohani's broader point in terms of the effectiveness of the bill, I think all the evidence suggests that integration is not a structural response. Much about integration, and the evidence points to integration about relationships. It's about how you improve outcomes, and it's also about how you build and strengthen that collaboration between a range of agencies. So my caution as Chief Executive of Healthcare Improvement Scotland would be in relation to the structural elements of the bill at the moment and the extent to which, if you're going to drive better outcomes, much of this is in relation to how you design and indeed collaborate between different agencies ultimately to drive those better outcomes. So that would be my, I suppose, principal note of caution and indeed in the submission that we've given to the Parliament. Thank you.
Rosemary.
Excuse me. I think I would echo my colleagues to the extent that it's this bill that we're commenting on. It's our comments that will enable others to make decisions about what happens to the bill. But I think, echoing what Robbie said, there are some concerns about the face of the bill as it currently stands. My locus is very much on the complaints elements of it. And I think part of the issue we're facing is there is not a huge amount of detail. Even though it's described as a framework bill, there are already existing statutory frameworks for complaint handling. And without a better understanding of the detail, notwithstanding some of my concerns about what it does say about complaints, I come back to the point about the structural things, about how we work better together, and I'm not sure that the face of the bill as it stands strengthens the collaborative working with the things that are already there. Now, that runs the risk of making complaints more, not less, complex for those trying to navigate the system, and that is a concern I have.
Thank you. And my last question, given that we are desperately tight for time, as always, in our last witnesses, we saw some evidence given about some of the changes that are required here and now. So could the panel tell me what changes that we could make here and now that this bill would mean it would be better? What is it that we can't do to make changes here and now for the betterment of people who both receive care and deliver care, that this bill is the only way to do it?
Miri.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. I think from our perspective, one of the key challenges we've had in reading the bill is that there isn't a clear definition of the workforce of the NCS that's referred to. I mean, obviously, as the SSSC is the professional regulator of the social work, social care and children and young people's workforce. But it's not clear to us from the bill the extent of that workforce that we regulate, how it will be encompassed within what's proposed around workforce. And there's some important elements within the bill where it's really, I think, important to us that clarity is there. So in the principles, there's the reference to employers of the workforce, ensuring they have an approach to fair work. So real clarity about what that means in terms of employers of the workforce that we think is important. There's reference when it talks about the National Care Board to the board having a role around, potentially a role around training, or funding of training for the workforce. So elements there where we think clarity around that would be really helpful.
Edith?
Thanks, Thanks very much, Convener. Just to echo what Marie's saying there, there are a number of points that we've also put in our submission in terms of clarity that would be really helpful, particularly around the principles. And we do recognise that some of the engagement we've had with the Bill team, we can see some of the changes within the principles in the amendments around that. However, there's still clarity required. The Care Inspectorate, as I said before, focuses on outcomes for people, and our quality improvement frameworks are aligned to the health and social care standards. We still do feel that in terms of the principles, they could be more outcome focused, and we do have some concerns around that in terms of us being able to carry out our role and being able to make an assessment of the quality of care if the principles are not more focused on outcomes. Also, some clarity around the role of the board in terms of improvement and also in terms of assessing quality, and how that might have an impact on the Care Inspectorate's work, and to avoid duplication or to avoid any potential gaps. So there are a number of areas there we have put in our submission points that are quite important to note.
Thank you. Robbie.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. If you take ourselves back to 2019 in the Ministerial Strategic Group, made a number of recommendations in relation to how we accelerate integration. And at that point, there were a range of recommendations made in 2019 in relation to collaborative leadership, in relation to how we share information, meaningful and sustained engagement, and effective strategic planning for improvement. And these were key recommendations by the then Cabinet Secretary, Jean Freeman. And then today we go to the memorandum supporting this bill at stage two in paragraph 80. There's a list of very similar recommendations, or at least actually duties, on the new National Care Service Board. So the question is, the things that were proposed in 2019, how do we advance them today, and particularly in the context of improvement and collaborative leadership, which are fundamental to ultimately driving that better integration and better outcomes I touched on earlier.
And Rosemary.
I'm going to focus specifically on complaints. There are three areas where we think there could be improvements. The first of these is around delegated services and who is responsible for complaint handling. Long before this, we've been concerned about the complex structure for complaints related to delegated services and a lack of clarity about what the relationship is between local authorities, health boards and health and social care partnerships. And when the HSCP structure was created, we asked at that time for it to be clear in secondary regulation where services were delegated through integrated joint boards. We asked that complaint handling should also be delegated, because that would have made it clearer for those receiving service, but also for those having to respond. And that didn't happen, and this would be a good opportunity to address that. Because fundamentally, especially for delegated services, it needs to be clearer for who's responsible for responding in the first instance, ensuring that those members of that partnership or bodies can share information between themselves. And I think that information sharing at the next level up, the regulatory and oversight level, also holds true. We can't always share the information that we think would be helpful to share. Now, what we have overlaid on this are multiple elements of governance structures, and one of the concerns that I have is it's not clear what oversight delegating organisations have of the complaints dealt with when the services are delegated. Now, why that's important is it's fundamental to learn from complaints. It's fundamental to make your services better, to ensure that people get a good service, and as a feedback route. So there is something around this that we think would be helpful to do. I also have a concern about complaint handling principles, because these are approved by the Scottish Parliament. So we were the first UK jurisdiction that actually did this. Parliament had an active interest in complaint handling and have had a commitment to improving it by improving complaint handling principles, more latterly, specifically in relation to child-friendly complaints.
So we're actually going to come on to that as a specific topic a bit further on, so that it might be an opportunity for you to elaborate a little bit more.
Okay, I'll stop with the first point then.
Thank you. I don't want to preempt some of the panel members' questions. Emma Harper has a supplementary.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a quick sup. Good morning to you all. Do you think the language of dead in the water is really helpful? Because isn't this about co-design? It's a framework bill. It's about like what the people with lived experience wanted. They want what Derek Feely recommended, which was a reform in social care. So isn't this about people coming around the table, having all the regular bodies, the people, the folk like yourself, coming to the table to get this right? We know bills get amended after stage one and stage two and even stage three amendments. So isn't this about everybody working together and not using language that's not helpful?
Edith?
I wanted to make the point that my colleagues have already made, in that structural change and legislative change alone will not actually, you know, create a social care system that will be better than it is now necessarily. There are many factors that have to be taken into consideration in terms of that. Things such as changing the culture, relationships, finance, resourcing, the leadership and the leadership styles, and as you've rightly said, hearing the voices of the people in the local communities and of people experiencing care. And certainly from our experience in the work that we've done, we've seen that across integration models, whereby the voice of the local community has not been heard, they haven't felt involved. So it's extremely important, I think, and the care inspectorate would certainly recognise that that reform that we're hoping for is not just about structure change and it's not just about legislative change.
And it is complex, everything, right? Remote and rural versus urban care might be delivered in a different way, and issues around accepting the and valuing what social workers do, and then the multidisciplinary team that we heard about before. So it's complicated, and the National Care Service Bill is part of how to address it so that care is delivered, looking at preventing folk from going into hospital in the first place, for instance, or re-ablement to allow them to be discharged from hospital to address delays. That's kind of where I'm after that. The whole system's quite complicated, so in order to help support better care in Scotland, this bill is part of the process.
Robbie?
Recognising the point, Convener, that Emma Harper has made, and I think the important point, if you go back to what Derek Feely intended, was that ultimately, social care is a springboard and not a safety net. And if we're going to move to a different way of thinking about social care, and which we set aside it being transactional, driven by crisis, to something which is actually supporting individuals and individuals feel involved in the redesign, then it goes to the heart, I said, of Emma Harper's comments, that we do need to involve ourselves in this in a very different way and to look at the outcomes for people. And if you go back to the very first meeting of Derek Feely's review group, the first thing he was tasked with was to look at the range of outcomes and expectations on public bodies, and there are a vast number of outcomes. So if we could even be focused on what we are looking for here and delivering it consistently, as opposed to it being, you know, a fight to get good social care, then I think we'd all be seeking that outcome. Thank you.
Thank you. Tess White.
My question is to Robbie Pearson, if I may, for Healthcare Improvement Scotland. What do you understand is the key purpose of the proposed National Care Service Board?
So the National Care Service Board is to give oversight for the implementation of the ultimate objectives set out in the bill, the oversight of the principles, ensuring there's a plan, ensuring that plan is executed well, and at a local level through the the establishment of the local boards, as in terms of the amendments to the 2014 Act. So it has a range of objectives, and these are set out, as I touched on earlier, in paragraph 80 of the memorandum. And they go through performance management, they go through setting standards for development within the National Care Service, and ultimately, I guess, about upholding and ensuring that the ultimate aims of those principles are consistently applied.
How would the board, in your view, support shared accountability? Because some people see that shared accountability is a fudge.
Well, I think at the moment, as I currently read it, you have a National Care Service Board that will be a public body, excuse me, which then brings its own further infrastructure and, I guess, governance and accountability arrangements into the system. So I think what the tension is, as I could best describe it in relation to the bill as it's currently presented, is between local decision-making, local accountability, and how that accountability will then be discharged in relation to the National Care Service Board without disturbing that local accountability, particularly for local government. If I just bring it back to Healthcare Improvement in Scotland, though, so at the moment, the system is not a system in which you can compartmentalise things. So if you take delayed discharges depends on good, high-quality primary care, depends on community care, and also depends on an effective hospital system. So my concern in relation to your point with regards to the National Care Service Board, how will it discharge its responsibilities in relation to social care and community care, but do in a way which still reflects the fact we're talking about a whole system? And as you say in the submission, my concern would be there would be two channels in relation to governance, one going up the National Health Service, principally hospitals, and one going up another channel related to community care, as yet to be defined in the context, or community health care rather, in the context of regulations coming forward. So I think that would be my concern, that we lose a bit of the whole system endeavour here if we have two parallel tracks. And the risk would be that, such as in the context of delayed discharges, which do require every bit of the system to be leaning in and supporting it, we end up with something that is more fragmented than we'd otherwise want.
And that's what you talked about in your submission. You talk about a potential fracturing of national oversight to some aspects of the NHS. Could you actually describe a bit more about that in detail, with this tension that you talk about between the National Care Service Board and the NHS boards?
Yeah, so we've obviously got 14 territorial health boards, and Healthcare Improvement in Scotland inspects those health boards for a range of services, and we do it often in conjunction with the Care Inspector in terms of more community health services and integration. But if you take the point around delayed discharges and that tension, so we are doing everything possible to support effective discharge from hospital. We've got a range of initiatives to keep people at home, such as hospital at home. We have things in relation to supporting frailty. We've got things in supporting improvements in relation to dementia care. So all of those things are part and parcel of a whole system response to supporting people to have more holistic care. So the risk would be that if we have two lines and channels of performance management, if that's the best way to describe it, one to the National Health Service in terms of Scottish Government Health Services, Health and Social Care Management Board, and another channel and line of governance, kind of describe it like that, to the National Care Service Board, it will be difficult in moments of stress and strain in the system as to how you reconcile different tensions and from performance management, but equally how you commission improvement. So how do we, if you go back to Derek Feely's comment, was how do we create a big and bold plan for improvement? So how do we reconcile that improvement and coming together to commission that improvement in a holistic way between the National Health Service and the National Care Service Board? So it works both ways, from the positive, and at the moments when there is stress and strain in the system, it could be quite challenging to reconcile the two.
Because when you talk about a fragmented system, you'll have the NCS board and the NHS board, but it seems like the poor relative of all this is primary healthcare. And so the fragmentation, primary healthcare is at the front end and should have more investment, but it seems that this could mean that primary healthcare just gets further left behind.
So it's important in the nature of the response, given that 90% of the care is outside the hospital, that primary care is fundamental to that. And we'd want to ensure, in relation to local boards, but also in the context of the whole system response, that primary care is factored into it. Because it isn't just the integration between primary care and community health services and social care. It's about the pathways between primary care and secondary care in supporting people with complex conditions or chronic disease management. So that would be absolutely critical in this as well, that that is actually given due regard to, because, as I say, and a point I'm making, emphasising, is that this genuinely is a whole system response, and everything, you know, in my career over 30 years is a demonstration the more you integrate, not just in the community, but between hospital and community services, the better outcomes.
But you're only as strong as your weakest link, and in all this, primary healthcare is the weakest link.
So primary healthcare is a fundamental part of the, absolutely, in relation to it. It's a gateway, it's a direct relationship that individuals have with immediate impact in relation to their healthcare needs, absolutely, in the community.
And for this to work, would you say that primary healthcare also needs further support?
So primary healthcare has to have that support. We are doing, at least for Healthcare Improvement Scotland, supporting all the things in relation to our community treatment support within the pilot areas. We're doing in supporting primary care, in for instance, in supporting pharmacotherapy to be rolled out. These are key things in releasing general practice to be doing supporting at a more specialist end of care and allowing other members of the multidisciplinary team to play their part in supporting people to remain independent and stay at home.
Thank you. And just if I can just ask Rosemary one question about, Rosemary, who, in your opinion, should be represented on the National Board to ensure that it functions in a way that does promote integration and best serves those who use care and support services?
Gosh, that's a tricky question. I can't give you a name of who, but
or
the
types
sort
of roles.
Of roles that are on there. There should almost certainly be representatives from each of the areas that health and care would cover. Because there has to be some element of understanding of how the other part of the system works. But I think more fundamentally, what is critical to a board is what's being trying to be achieved through co-design, and that's where the user and service user or those who support service user voice comes in, because already in many boards, the way the appointment process works, we get very, very good, able, capable people who are, you know, expert in governance or subject areas. But given the genesis of the National Care Service Bill and the co-design and trying to meet what service users are after, then I would say they should be part of that oversight too.
And do you think there should be both, so roles, similar roles represented on each to make sure there's consistency?
I'm not sure that's how consistency is achieved. I think it's more to do with what the respective organisations are asked to do. Because you can achieve consistency with how a board is supported.
Sorry, that's not answering the question. I suppose the key question is what role should be on the National Care Service Board. So can I just throw that out to the panel, if any other panel member has a view on what roles should be on the National Care Service Board. Marie.
Yeah, thank you. We welcome, obviously, there being recognition about the voice of the workforce being on the board, but it brings us back to that question about what is the workforce. And I know you've already heard evidence last week about the perspectives that each element of the workforce would...
Sorry, that's not answering the question. That's almost drilling down on saying somebody from the workforce needs to be on the board, which I accept. But does any of the panel have a view on what roles should be on the National Care Service Board? I mean, if you haven't got any view, that's also fine. It's something that needs to be addressed. But does any of the panel members have a view on what roles should be on the National Care Service Board? Thank you. No.
I think what might be helpful is to understand. I'm not sure I understand what you mean by role. It's quite a broad term.
Don't worry. We'll move on. Back to convener. Thank you.
Thank you. It's Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. I think quite a few of my questions will probably be for Rosemary first, but if anybody else wants to come in, that would be brilliant. The sections relating to complaints have not really changed between the bills introduced and the Scottish Government's proposed Stage 2 amendments. Could you give us your views on what the implications of establishing a new complaints process as part of the National Care Service would be, and how should issues of duplication or other potential issues related to the creation of a new complaints process be addressed?
The starting point I'm going to come to is what is a complaint, actually, because that's not a trivial question. So in relation to care and health, that one word means a multitude of things. So complaints about social services, local authority care, are covered by the SPSO Act, and they're subject to model complaints handling and are subject to the principles approved by Parliament. Complaints about healthcare, whilst I have oversight and monitor and take complaints about them, they're actually subject to the NHS complaints handling procedures under the Patients' Rights Scotland Act. Complaints about HSCPs can be covered by either or both. Complaints about registered care provision are with the Care Inspectorate. Complaints about the National Care Service itself as an organisation would be subject to model complaints handling. Now, we already, with the exception of the last one that doesn't exist, we already work relatively collaboratively and know where to signpost things. And I think, for me, the issue is probably in the way that it's worded at Section 14, because receiving complaints about services is not the same as responding to complaints. Passing complaints on to the appropriate person sounds great in principle, but I'm not sure that that would actually help the people making complaints if they're just going to be passed on, because already within the system we pass complaints on, we signpost, and that puts all the onus back on the service user, who the very fact they're making a complaint means they're either not getting the service or they're almost certainly going through something stressful and difficult. And I think, for me, what was disappointing was that there wasn't more emphasis on the advocacy role rather than a signposting role. So that's my first really big concern about what I didn't see change, which I think is almost something you could achieve now if there was better advocacy and better support for people complaining through the care, because even within current structures, there's still a level of integration at the point of delivery. And it's hugely stressful making a complaint. And actually, if there was something that was more of an advocacy role, and I acknowledge that comes with pound notes attached to it, you can often sort something out without the need to put somebody through complaints. I think as well, in a more integrated model, what's going to be really important is the, even within our existing complaints frameworks, the order in which things are looked at. Because it's very easy to take a great big complaint with lots of points to it. Oh, that bit needs to go to the Care Inspectorate. That needs to go to the IJB. Oh, actually, no, that probably needs to go to the local authority. And just helping somebody would, I think, be of benefit. The other thing related to complaints handling, thank you for stopping me earlier, is Section 15 of the Act. And I've got real concerns about this, not just for myself, but for all parliamentary office holders and for other agencies as well, because effectively what the Act currently provides for is an affirmative process for changing primary legislation of office holders. And every other piece of legislation has a super affirmative process. That gets more parliamentary scrutiny and has to be proposed by the corporate body. And we asked for that at stage one, not just for ourselves, but obviously for other office holders and potentially the other, the impact on other agencies. But I also have a concern that what's good enough in other bits of legislation is not included here in terms of preserving the things that Parliament has already scrutinised and had an opportunity to scrutinise. So it's both ends of it, really. It's the framework within which we currently operate potentially could be changed by this, with, as it's written, not a huge amount of parliamentary scrutiny, but more fundamentally, a complaints service, a truly good service, would be the one that helps navigate, not just signpost, in my view.
That's really useful, thank you. So to come back to the advocacy piece, there obviously is advocacy mentioned within the bill. So in your opinion, is it the bit on complaints that needs change to better integrate that advocacy piece into there? Or is it the advocacy sections of the bill that need changed to better reflect those expectations around how people will be helped to navigate? Because obviously information is part of that role, as well as advocacy as well, which we've heard from a lot of people is actually a really important role as well in giving people the tools they need to navigate what you've already outlined is a very complicated system.
I think either or both. In terms of a complaint service that receives complaints, that of itself could be complex because once you've received a complaint, whatever process you pass it on by, whether it's through an advocacy or a signposting, you are inevitably going to be adding time to how long it takes. So I think there is something in the complaint side of it that needs to recognise that it should not lengthen the process. On the advocacy side, I think that's more where perhaps some of the detail could be that complaints are cross-referenced to. The example that I would use for health complaints is patient advisory services, PASS. I from my perspective, that works very well. PASS, who represent patients making complaints, they're very good at it and they're very supportive and they're able to manage expectation as well as anything else. So I just think we need to adjust the lens on where this is, away from we're going to do complaints to how do we facilitate and enable complaints to work, which is pretty much what the co-design has asked for.
Yes, absolutely. That's really useful. Obviously, there's a practical implementation of this new complaints process being added to the complaints landscape that's already quite cluttered. And I think I've said all along that the devil is in the implementation of this bill. Do you see that extra complaints body causing issues, or in your opinion, is it more just replicating the work that you've already referenced and how different bodies work together to make sure that complaints are resolved and people feel supported? Or are we reaching that sort of critical mass of numbers of bodies to complain to where it is becoming so complicated it's impenetrable?
I'm going to draw an analogy with my colleague here about the workforce is not particularly well defined. The bill says a complaints service. It doesn't say a complaints body. But there seems to be assumptions that actually it's a new complaints body, or it's actually a complaints service that's going to look at complaints. And I think there needs to just be a bit more definition around what is envisaged. I think what is envisaged is something that works with the current structures, but that's not really what the face of the bill says.
Thanks. Edith and Marie want to come in on this question to Gillian. So Edith, we'll start with you.
Thanks very much, convener. And I suppose it's to pick up the point of is it a cluttered
kind of landscape in terms of complaints. And certainly from the Care Inspectorate's perspective, we really welcome some conversations through ELAG and through the working group around complaints. As Rosemary's already stated, we're in a unique situation as a regulator in that we have a complaint service for regulated care services across the lifespan. So at the moment, there are around 11,000 regulated care services in Scotland. And all through the Bill's development, we've emphasised the importance of the Care Inspectorate retaining the complaints function that we have. It works well in our view, and over the years we've had an increase in the amount of complaints that we receive. So currently we receive around 6,000 complaints a year. Now that's increased from 2011, where we had around about 2,800 complaints. So we have, there's a greater awareness of our complaints process, and also I think people are more aware of their rights and what they expect in terms of good quality care. And you know, we believe that these may be reasons why the complaints have increased. Our complaints function is really important in that it informs our scrutiny process and priorities. So information that we receive from complaints is taken, and we manage our inspections on a risk-based process. Therefore, the information from complaints is added to that, and then we can focus our finite resources more effectively and efficiently to high-risk services. So it's incredibly important, we believe, to retain that function. What we would say is that the landscape needs to be more simple. So it needs to be simple and clear, and it needs to enable people to raise issues rather than have something that's put in that actually then prevents or people feel just unable. It's just too much for them to complain. I mean, the point around advocacy around complaints is very, very important. And I think where somebody perhaps finds it challenging to describe what their issue is, then if somebody can advocate for them, I think it allows a service such as the Care Inspectorate's complaint service to be clearer on what the issue is and also be able to address it in a more timely way and in a better way.
Emily.
Thank you. I think we've heard a strong articulation there of the complexity of the complaints landscape. Just to add to that complexity is the role of the SSSC and other professional regulators, where we're not complaints resolution bodies. We look at the fitness to practice of those registered with us. But when people who are using services or their family members come directly to us raising an issue, it can be very difficult for them to understand that very specific role that we have. And I think one of the things that we have been raising as part of the work stream is just that however this work unfolds, it needs to be not do so in a way that leads to people being automatically signposted to, for example, us as the professional regulator, because there is an element of it that is about an individual practitioner. And I think that's one of the strengths of the current system, is we work really closely with the Care Inspectorate. Complaints that come to them about services, if there is an element about them that's about fitness to practice of a registered worker, the Care Inspectorate refer that on to us. So I think we would want to ensure whatever comes out doesn't avoid unnecessary referrals, not purely for us in terms of workload, but actually a person making a complaint being referred around lots of different bodies who aren't going to provide them with a resolution isn't helpful to them either. And we would also support that point about advocacy. Our experience is that if people do have proper support around navigating processes and understanding the remits of bodies, that's really helpful for them.
Thank you. Rosemary?
I just wanted to add on, coming back to the co-design elements of it, a word that frequently comes up is accessible and accessibility. And I think we think of complaints not being accessible. Actually, for each of us as an organisation, complaints are accessible. I think it's the system that is where the accessibility is an issue. But there are different interpretations of the word accessible. Now, we are aware, and I think others are, that there is a reluctance to complain sometimes about care, because it's not just a case of you don't know who to. You might be worried about complaining. Will that impact on the care you're getting or the care that a loved one is getting? And I think that advocacy piece is also about support and confidence in the system. The other thing that it's fundamental to good complaint handling that we absolutely mustn't lose sight of is whatever we have, we've got to make sure that A, it's the right route to the remedy and the redress, because the redress will look different depending on what the complaint is. But it's also about capturing that learning. And I would hope that this is a really good opportunity to collectively capture learning in a more holistic way as well.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that culture piece is about complaints is really important as well. And I suppose there's only so much the bill in itself can do to get us there. But I'm sure other colleagues might want to come on to that. So thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Couple of questions about the establishment of a National Social Work Agency and Chief Social Work Advisor. Just interested to hear what your opinion is about that, and how should a National Social Work Agency complement the work of current social work regulators, for instance. Marie, you've got your hand up.
We are supportive of the introduction of a National Social Work Agency. The Office of the Chief Social Work Advisor in Scottish Government, that is our sponsor department. So we obviously work very, very closely with the Chief Social Work Advisor. I think paragraph 154 of the memorandum sets out the intention as to what the foundations of that National Social Work Agency would be around equipping and resourcing the workforce to undertake their duties, looking at that implementation of national policy in a consistent way, and looking at the policy development across the profession. We've had discussions about how the National Social Work Agency would work with us around our role in setting standards for education, quality assuring the education programmes, setting out continuous professional learning of social workers. We're content that it would be complementary to our role as the professional regulator and would be an important focus for the profession and part of that progress towards there being parity in terms of the profession of social work.
And we've heard that, so it kind of goes back to my earlier question about the bill not being dead in the water and, like, not using that language, because we know that we've heard that the social work profession sees the creation of an agency as critical to the survival of the profession. And the previous panel talked about parity and people understanding what social workers actually do, and then looking at how do we support standards of social work education. And there's lots of really good language in here about empowerment, co-production, person-centred care, and values of what we would like for anybody that was receiving care in Scotland. So I'd be interested in any specific other, I don't know, ideas that you might have about what the National Social Work Agency could additionally do. And in terms of one of the other things that's been brought up is that the difference between an executive agency and then a non-departmental, completely separate from the government. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think from our perspective, the mechanism by which it's delivered would be a matter for Parliament at the moment, as it is in the bill, to make a decision on. I think either of those vehicles we would still work with in a supportive way around how it would improve the profession.
Okay. Edith has,
yeah. Thanks very much. Thanks, Convener. Just really to support what Marie said as well in terms of the National Social Work Agency, the Care Inspector would certainly support the proposed intention and ambition in the draft legislation. And we certainly believe that placing the role on a statutory footing recognises that unique role of social work, social workers and social work managers, and would help in promoting that and the value of social work across health and social care. And it's important. We would find it helpful to understand how the National Social Work Agency would work alongside existing regulators such as the SSSC, and it would be helpful and important to understand roles and responsibilities as the agency is developed as well.
And we heard last week that the multidisciplinary team approach to supporting people in the community is absolutely vital, and a National Social Work Agency could help basically engage and support the wider multidisciplinary team as well, and the setting the standards for future social workers and like a graduate apprenticeship model of bringing social workers into the profession. Is that something that an agency could be part of delivering?
Yes,
thank you. I know that graduate apprenticeship was announced last year, last week at Social Work Scotland conference, that the steps being taken to bring that in. So absolutely, I think that's one of the areas that we would be working alongside a National Social Work Agency around how it would be delivered. I suppose just a point around that we put in our submission about leadership for social care. And there is, I think, still a question about where that exists and that role is within this legislation or wider. And I suppose also just to make the point that we do set standards as well, national occupational standards that underpin the professional qualifications that the social care workforce that we regulate, so over 100,000 people in social care that we regulate are required to obtain mandatory qualifications that are underpinned by national occupational standards to ensure that consistency of practice of the workforce. Obviously, the bill's not changing that, but it's just to make the point that there are foundations there already around the wider workforce and the professionalisation of that workforce.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks to the panel so far. I just want to turn to monitoring, improvement and commissioning. Just want to ask what your overall impression is of the proposed Stage 2 amendments relating to monitoring and improvement of a national care service. How might the proposals change existing practice in monitoring and improvement, given that a number of organisations and bodies that you represent here already play a part in these areas? Does anyone have a... Yep, thank you, Ms McIntosh.
Thanks very much for the question. It's an interesting question, and I suppose the Care Inspectorate would seek some clarity on the monitoring and improvement aspect in terms of the board's role. We've previously sought some reassurances from Scottish Government, and we have had some feedback around how that role might interact with, for example, the Scottish Learning and Improvement Framework, and also how it would interact with our own role in the Care Inspectorate, where we have a duty to further improvement as well. We have got a fairly strong track record of supporting improvement in the care sector. We have designed, developed and delivered a number of national programmes of quality improvement to support the care sector, and also local programmes as well. And also we work with other organisations such as SSSC and Healthcare Improvement Scotland and others to promote improvement and to run programmes of improvement in the care sector. In fact, we've just completed over the last month or so a cohort one of a care home improvement programme in which some of Marie's colleagues assisted us, and we're already seeing significant improvements in terms of our inspectors going out and inspecting because of the work we've been able to do. And we focused that on our scrutiny activity. So the information that we have from scrutiny, we've been able to invite care homes to take part in that, and we're already seeing the difference that that has made. So there are a number of questions there in terms of how the legislation in the bill would impact our role and remit, and we would really appreciate further conversations about that as we go forward.
The bill as drafted proposes that the National Care Service Board would be responsible for monitoring improvement. Is that something that you would agree is the most appropriate place for responsibility to lie?
So I think that's a difficult question to answer, because I don't think we've got enough information about what that might look like.
Okay.
And how that would impact on the role, remit and responsibilities of other bodies such as the Care Inspectorate. So we would need to understand that a bit better and be really keen to engage in that conversation.
OK, Mr Pearson.
Yeah, if I can, I can pick up that point. So if we read what's said, and as I say, in that paragraph 80 of the memorandum, it's giving a role for the National Care Service Board in setting standards, but also in relation to performance management and oversight. So it's a level of the National Care Service Board holding to account, which is different from quality assurance and external assurance of the local system, which is about driving improvement. So we have to be quite careful in the language here between external assurance of the system and performance management of the system, and which can create, let's just say, some difficulties in relation to the balance of roles and responsibilities between the National Care Service Board and, for instance, Healthcare Improvement Scotland and the Care Inspectorate.
OK. Just also want to turn to the role of research in assessing unmet and met need. There has been, you know, a scarce landscape in this kind of area of research funding for some time, and a recent tender for this research package wasn't awarded by the Scottish Government. Do you have a view on the implications of that, particularly on the strategic prioritisation of a National Care Service workforce planning and establishing an improvement framework?
If it can come back, and I'm not actually aware of the details, Convener, I'm happy to come back on that
okay.
point. But in relation to understanding the needs of individual citizens and how they access social care, how they access community health services, I think everything from Derek Feely's report was emphasising the challenge in relation to it being a bit of a battleground, and actually how you hold on to your existing social care, let alone needing social care as your needs evolve. In relation to Healthcare Improvement Scotland, in relation to informing policy and research, we have the work on gathering views, which is something we commission with different bits of the service at different points along the way. And we also have the Citizens Panel, which is an important opportunity, again, in allowing different topics to be used to inform policy in relation to the design of the service, whether it's health and social care. So I see these as being important parts of whatever we do in relation to the next steps in this bill, and ensuring that we can genuinely and meaningfully ensure that policy and delivery are meeting the needs of individuals.
Okay. Just also want to turn to how strategic planning and ethical commissioning is currently delivered and supported. To what extent does the bill offer an opportunity to enhance a culture of organisational improvement and learning? Is that something you see as an opportunity, or is it something that could potentially be frustrated?
Others may want to answer more in relation to the ethical commissioning point, but I think one of the major opportunities presented in advancing our improvements in social care is to define fairly clearly the infrastructure we need for improvement, and Edith touched on that in relation to improvement. So we already have a pretty good track record in Scotland in relation to the Scottish Patient Safety Programme, which is at scale, which is in which we built the will, in which we actually advanced that with local teams and ensured we drove through excellent delivery in relation to sustainable outcomes and better, ultimately, safer care. So how do we take some of the learning from that, I think, was a challenge from Derek Feely, and how you then use that at scale in relation to social care. But social care is very different in relation to how you do that. But I think there is an opportunity here in the alignment of effort and improvement in that landscape, and about how the different bodies work together to ensure at scale we can deliver those better outcomes.
Okay. Is there any other perspectives on this?
I was just going to pick up on the Fair Work and the commissioning point, that just going back to the principles in the bill around those who employ the workforce having to approach that in a way that is an exemplar of fair work. If we look at the workforce that we regulate, they can't do that unless, or they can't provide the right support to people they're caring for unless they're supported, they're given time for their professional development, they're paid in a way that gives them parity with health. So I think the link between Fair Work and ethical commissioning needs to be there to make that happen for the whole of, certainly from our perspective, the regulated workforce.
Okay, thank you very much. Yep.
A couple of points around commissioning. So I mentioned earlier that together with Healthcare Improvement Scotland that we inspect social services and integration arrangements, and that includes commissioning. And over a number of years, we've conducted a number of inspections, really since 2014. And in six of these, we focused exclusively on strategic commissioning. So in terms of our evidence from that, some of the themes that have come through is that lack of good quality data informing commissioning, and especially personal outcomes data, which is obviously critically important in getting it right, and that frontline staff feel a disconnect from commissioning decisions as well, and a lack of meaningful involvement of people experiencing care in commissioning decisions. So that's our evidence in terms of these inspections that we've done. In terms of ethical commissioning, clearly, you know, we would support that and support what Marie has said in terms of that Fair Work and the importance of people experiencing the right care at the right time, but also that social care workforce are remunerated in the right way and they have the best terms and conditions. Hope that's helpful.
The proposed amendments suggest removing the reference, explicit reference to ethical commissioning from the face of the bill. Are you concerned by that?
I suppose I would just reiterate the importance of ethical commissioning. We would certainly be promoting that in terms of our conversations with local areas.
Okay. Just to ask if anyone else has a view on the drafting as proposed and that removal of explicit reference to ethical commissioning. Is that something you would rather see on the face of the bill?
I think just going back to my point that I don't see how you can deliver Fair Work across that wider workforce without ethical commissioning being in place. Okay. So I'm sure that there will be very strong voices saying that should be on the face of the bill to achieve that.
OK. Thanks very much.
Thank you. And Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Katia. I have a couple of questions just around some quite specific issues. I'm interested in Anne's Law, and just as we've heard in other panels, just are we able to implement that now, or do we need to wait for the bill, and how do you think we might be able to do that? And, you know, of course, what your views are on that. I wondered whether Edith might have a view on this.
Yeah, thanks very much. Thanks, convener. I suppose to say that currently the Care Inspectorate is supporting the kind of intention of Anne's Law, if you like, through in care homes, through the health and social care standards, with the two additional standards that are in there. We're doing that with all registered care homes for adults and older people, and they're expected to meet these two additional standards at the moment. We have work ongoing, it's called Meaningful Connections Project, where we've been working with the sector very closely in terms of supporting them to understand the importance and to enable them, you know, to not just about visiting, but about connecting in lots of different ways and trying to support the people experiencing care to be really citizens of their local communities and the importance of that to people. And I suppose what we've been doing is just making sure that that voice around the fact that, you know, that meaningful connection doesn't diminish as we get older. It's the same whether we're younger or older, and the importance of that in terms of living our lives well. And through the work, we've seen a real difference in terms of people experiencing care and the difference that's made when they've had these connections with people they love and people that are important to them in life, or where they've had the opportunity to get out into the local community and perhaps restart some hobbies or just connect and be part of that community. So that work's ongoing at the moment, and, you know, there's a real sense of well-being for people when they're able to connect. So we're very supportive of Anne's Law. We are continuing that work and we'll continue to do it. And we do, in terms of the health and social care standards, so they are key to our inspection frameworks. And these two new standards in there, you know, we are looking at that when we're out on inspection. I mean, in terms of the legislative process, that's not something for the Care Inspectorate really to make a decision on or have much comment on, but we would say we're fully supportive of it. And, you know, if that if Anne's Law can provide more consistency in terms of people being able to connect with people who are important to them and with their local communities, then that would be a wonderful thing.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. So that it is something you promote, but legislation might help just to cement that. I don't know if Mary might...
Yeah, we're obviously very supportive of Anne's Law as well. I think for the workforce, it's been such a challenging area to navigate, and having clarity and support, legislative support around that would be welcomed. I know there have been comments from other people who've made submissions about how it's been technically worded and whether it should be extended. So we don't have any comment on that, but just to say that we're supportive of it in principle.
Lovely, thank you. Does anybody else want to come in on that one? Okay. The next question I have is just to ask around, are you happy with amendments in terms of Children's and Justice Services? Would that be something that you would have a view on? We've had some of the panels have particular, you know, sort of direction for us on that. Does anybody on this panel comment? Mary?
Yes, so in our submission we have said that we'd be supportive of them being included. Really conscious that there have been some very thoughtful submissions around the complexity of that and questions over whether the evidence exists for it. We've been looking at it through that lens of a professional regulator and just a concern about fragmentation of the profession. So from our perspective, purely from that, having the profession as one would be preferable, but really conscious it's a hugely complicated area and there are a lot of differing views and challenges, and anything that was bringing it in or making changes would have to be really carefully thought through and timed.
Okay. Does anybody else want to come in on that? Yeah.
Thank you. Really, just to echo what Maria has said, we appreciate there are arguments for and against, and we appreciate further consideration, careful consideration that's been given. The main point that I would make would be about the disaggregation of services and the concerns around that, and we'd probably guard against that, the importance of social work services being coherent and working together across the lifespan. That's really significant. Therefore, if there was disaggregation of services, that would be a concern.
Just one last question. If the bill progresses, would there be a particular amendment or a particular part that you feel should be prioritised to be worked on at this stage two? Does anybody have... Yeah.
I think for me it's that issue about workforce and definition around that. For us it's the most important thing about the intention behind the bill is about how to really support and improve the workforce and I think it needs that clarity, so I think that's the area we would want to focus on.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Yeah, at the end.
If it's an open question in relation to areas for beyond children and justice, I think it would be worth revisiting where the evidence has taken us before in relation to integration, which is about relationships. Mm-hmm. It is about how you create the culture, the conditions at a local level to sustain improvement, and also also some of the limitations of legislation. So having a legal duty to collaborate does not make collaboration necessarily any better. It is about how you sustain those relationships over time and how you allow the structures to evolve and to give best effect to the original intention. So I suppose that would be my note of encouragement in relation to what might go in the future.
Can I just follow up? Do you mean that we should have some of that in the bill about how we deliver?
Well, a number of points are made in the bill in relation to that, in relation to culture, to leadership, to collaboration. I think my note of caution would be the extent to which you can legislate for that when it is about how you create the conditions and the relationships at a local level. And having worked in a territorial board and worked with a council, a lot of it comes down to not necessarily the structures, the committees, the governance, the accountability, but how individuals work together ultimately to achieve better outcomes.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Very much. Can I thank the panel for their evidence this morning? Very grateful for the information you've given to the committee, and it will be certainly very useful in our scrutiny of the amendments at stage two. And I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting to change panels. Thank you. We continue our scrutiny of the Scottish Government's proposed Stage 2 amendments to the National Care Service Scotland Bill with a third panel of witnesses. And I welcome to the committee Ayla Davey, KC, Faculty of Advocates, Jennifer Payton, Head of Policy, Law Society of Scotland, and Jan Savage, Executive Director of Scottish Human Rights Commission, and hopefully we'll be joined shortly by Suzanne McGuinness, Executive Director of Social Work Mental Welfare Commission for Scotland. And we'll move straight to questions, and Sandish Gulhani.
Thank you, convener, and good afternoon to the panel. Declaration of interest as a practicing NHS GP. So can I start by asking the panel, do you feel that there is anything in this bill which would mean that we could improve care delivered to people and also improve the staff and their well-being?
Who would like to start on that question? Jan?
Thank you, convener. Certainly, the Commission's concern with the National Care Service Bill as amended and as proposed is with the right to independent living. So for so many people who rely on social care for disabled people, older people, people with long-term conditions, social care is independent living. And we believe that whilst the bill, as proposed, has clarified in stronger terms the human rights implications of that, we believe it could go further and there could be more specificity on the face of the bill in respect of what Article 19 of the UN Convention on the Rights of Disabled People means in respect of independent living. In doing so, that provides greater read-across into the principles, the standards, and therefore the delivery of a national care service which upholds that. In terms of the workforce, that's not an area that the Commission would be qualified to comment on, unfortunately.
Ayla, did you want to come in on that?
And I'm conscious that we didn't put a specific response in for the amendments, so the faculty's position really remains with the original paper that was produced. This is a bill which has a lot of aspirations. In general terms, these have got to be seen as positive ways of implementing the change that's intended. The difficulty that we see from a legislative perspective is that this is a framework bill. It concentrates on structure. A lot of the detail in terms of how the care would be changed or how it would be improved is really going to be secondary legislation. So it's difficult at this stage to say with clarity how that will be affected and whether it will improve.
Sandish?
And so would anyone else like to comment, or is that everyone?
I can come in on a very high level. So the Law Society of Scotland has said throughout our engagement with this bill that it's really important that it's clear on how a new piece of legislation in this area would add value really to the existing complex legal and organisational framework that already exists in social care, how it's going to interact with the many existing structures that are already in place, and really importantly, how it'll improve outcomes for end users. I think the bill, as my colleagues have said, is a framework bill at the moment, and so a lot of the detail we need to really be sure about that isn't available at this moment in time.
Thank you. So, Ms. Eddy, the right to independent living, is this not something that we could do right now without the bill?
We could, however, it needs to be strengthened. So at this stage, the Scottish Government have at this point decided to pause the progression of the Human Rights Bill, which would have taken the right to independent living amongst a variety of other human rights instruments and given them effect in Scots law. What that means is it takes a right from being an aspiration and something that's intended to happen to being something which must happen, and that there would be legal routes to redress if it doesn't.
And so there is welcome development, I have to say, in respect of the bill as has been amended to give greater clarity of the human rights instruments that are to be given due regard to in respect of the National Care Service Bill. However, we do believe that it could go further to ensure that that right to independent living is enshrined. There are words such as concepts of supporting and the principles people to live independently. We believe that that could be strengthened to align better with the language of the CRPD. And what that would do is it would give greater clarity to duty bearers, to people who use social care, and ultimately, potentially, if things get to a stage of having to be reviewed, it could give greater clarity in respect of review of decisions around funding, around quality of care, and so on and so forth. So yes, the treaty which defines the right to independent living is already ratified by the state, but the mechanisms to make that real are not there. And it would appear to the Commission that in a piece of legislation so significant to so many disabled people, older people, to enshrine that right to independent living in the face of the legislation would really, really help to deliver the policy intent of the bill.
Thank you. Now, in our last session, we heard from Robbie about collaborative leadership, and paragraph 80 of the memorandum talks about collaborative leadership. In last week's committee, we heard that this bill is unique in uniting most of Civic Scotland against it. And we have also heard that COSLA is looking to withdraw its support from this bill. So the idea of collaborative leadership seems to completely gone. So given that has happened, do you feel this bill is dead in the water? And I use those words on purpose, because we shouldn't be scared of governmental spads not liking language used in committee. So do you think the bill is dead in the water if we have a lack of collaborative leadership from most of Civic Scotland?
Certainly from the faculty's perspective, we're not here to comment on the political side of things. We're here to talk about how the legislative framework works in a legal sense. Certainly, I think the language you're using there is quite emotive, but it's certainly not something the faculty will be looking to comment on.
Does anyone else have an opinion?
Has a comment.
Okay. Given that this is, and this is my last question, given that this is a framework bill and we don't have details of how the bill is actually going to be coming into effect, do you feel that this is the best way of trying to deliver for carers and for people who receive care? Or do you think there might be another more simple way of doing this that gives clarity to people? And I would like to directly ask a lawyer's opinion on this, if that would be okay.
There is certainly... So you have three people here very qualified to answer that question, but I think certainly that was the concern that the faculty raised from the get-go with the bill, that it's... There's always got to be a balance between actually affecting change in some manner, but doing it in a way that can be properly scrutinised, and starting with framework legislation and then having to implement a lot of the detail with secondary legislation can always potentially be a hostage to fortune. So that's always been a concern that we have raised. So I suppose it's a balance, because there will never be any perfect piece of legislation that will solve everything. This is an area where we already have very layered legislation. So one of the difficulties that we face at the moment is that it's quite impenetrable sometimes for people to work out exactly what the proper rights and obligations are in the care system. So that's, as an approach, it's one that I think... can have some difficulties. A lot of the detail is still to be filled in with secondary legislation. That's still the case, although some of the structures here are being changed by the proposed amendment. We're still in a position where a lot of the detail is still to come. And obviously secondary legislation is not afforded the same level of scrutiny, there's also a risk that there's a perception that some of the principles have already been identified and agreed upon when people subsequently down the line are looking at secondary legislation. So it sometimes is not afforded quite the same precedence when it's being scrutinised. I don't know if there is a perfect solution to that. Certainly, as a faculty, we don't have any particular proposals to say here is a better way of doing it. So we simply flag up that we have some concerns, and we certainly would look to be seeing greater scrutiny for any secondary legislation coming forward.
Thank you.
Just to be very clear, the Law Society of Scotland, we don't take a policy position on whether there should or should not be a national care service. That's not a matter we would take a position on. What we're concerned about is good law. It's about the legislative process. So we have submitted written evidence to the committee highlighting the concerns that we do have around this bill, and particularly the point we've got to here at stage two, where really some quite fundamental changes are being proposed to the bill as introduced. A lot of the evidence that was taken at stage one on this bill has probably been largely superseded by the changes that have been made. And I'm talking about structural changes, I'm talking about accountability, so really quite significant aspects of our proposed National Care Service. Our view is that where there are changes like that that would be made to reflect really significantly revised policy intentions, that is going to limit the scope for full and effective parliamentary scrutiny of a bill. So we are now concerned, and we've said this in our written evidence, as to whether this process is consistent with the creation of good law. So that's law that's clear, effective, efficient, and that achieves its intended outcomes without unintended consequences.
Any further questions, Sanders?
No, that was my final question.
Okay, thank you. Before we move on, can I just remind members I expect them to be courteous to each other? I accept emotions run high on certain things. And I've also been informed that Suzanne McGuinness has given us her apologies. Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. My first question is to Jennifer, if I may. So, Jennifer, what do you understand as being the purpose of the proposed National Care Service Board?
Thank you. Of the board itself. Just bring that section in my notes. My understanding is that what's now being proposed is a new public body with a separate identity from the Scottish Government, and that's reflected in the updated policy memorandum. But I do also note from the policy memorandum that the details of how that board will work in practice are to be informed by further co-design and stakeholder engagement. So from that point of view, I'm not sure we know all the details of exactly how that will work. I think I would just reiterate that if there's going to be a board, and we do welcome that there is now additional detail on what that board will look like in terms of the proposed stage two amendments, which wasn't present when we engaged with the bill at the stage one debate. So I do welcome that additional detail that is now available. I think we are still a little bit concerned about how exactly that additional layer of governance that's being added to that really quite complex environment that I mentioned earlier, how that will lead to improved quality and consistency for social care users.
Okay, so rather than following on, it's just like what's the purpose? But so my follow-up question is about shared accountability. So in terms of shared accountability, in your opinion, what extent would the shared accountability help with delivery of the purpose of the board's objectives? Because some people think that shared accountability could be a fudge, and it's very difficult to get traction on things.
I don't think that that's something that the Law Society of Scotland would necessarily want to express a view on at this moment in time, when I don't think there's an awful lot of the detail we would need available.
And that's no problem. So I will go back to the submission. So your submission suggests that it's unclear how the National Care Service Board will lead to, and I quote, improved quality and consistency of social care services.
deliver improved oversight and accountability, and how unnecessary bureaucracy, duplication and expenditure will be avoided. So do you have anything further to say on that to the committee?
No, I think I would just leave it with the terms of written submission
right.
on that point.
Thank you. And if I can go to Isla. So in your submission, Isla, you said the bill does not contain provision to strengthen cooperation between the National Care Boards and local authorities. Is it possible to just expand a bit on that?
I should clarify, we didn't put a response in for the amendments, for the original ones.
Your
so,
previous response,
yes,
thank you.
Obviously, so far as the faculty was approaching this, the faculty committee was approaching it, this seems like an approach which changes the proposed structure. So instead of starting with a totally blank slate, you know, this idea now that they will take a model which is there in form of the integrated authorities and actually take that idea of having the combined, you know, healthcare and local authority care, and then actually put the boards in place which will resemble that to some extent. We don't have a comment on that as an approach. You know, that's as a policy matter. If that's seen to be a way forward which will work and on which agreement can be reached, then the faculty wouldn't say whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. Certainly, it seems. It addresses some of the concerns in our original response about keeping continuity there, having some accountability that's actually between different parties. I can see there's a concern that it might be a little bit of a fudge insofar as there's going to be a compromise there, but we don't have an official position on that.
There's something that's so important as the National Care Service, and a new National Care Service should require clarity if it's going to cut through and deliver. And in your original submission, you actually said it could be several years before areas which are the worst served by social care services could hope to see any improvement. There are no interim measures proposed for areas of service or services which are recognised as currently being badly served. So I suppose the point there is if there are concerns already addressed that the worst served will not be impacted by this for several years, and if there's shared accountability at the top, which actually could, we talked about in the previous panel, the word that was used was fragmented. So if you've got fragmented leadership and then the concern that your organisation has expressed is that it's going to be years before it'll make any impact, then that suggests that it's going to be fraught with issues.
Well, I mean, again, we're not in a position to talk about that. We don't have that expertise. We don't have that knowledge about the fundamental substance of the care system. From a legislative perspective, I think the concerns that we raised about the impact further down the line or the time that it will take was echoed in many responses. I mean, whilst it's appreciated that what's being attempted here is to get the structures in place and to have that aspect covered by the legislation, there's no doubt that there's a concern that some of the real substance, which was in the Feely report, some of the ambitions there are still not being met. So it's all very well to say this legislation is required and it's important and we need to get the structures right, but that's not to say that we can leave everything else in the meantime. So I think the concern that we raised at that point is echoed by a number of organisations saying, well, there are real needs that require to be met and none of that's going to be addressed by this legislation.
I accept that, and this is not the area of expertise in social care, but one area that is in your expertise area is, do you have a view from a legislative point of view in terms of how the Scottish Government is approaching the detail of the board in the bill?
I would echo Jenner's first comments on lack of clarity at this stage. So what we seem to have is an approach at the first stage which said we should start with a clean slate. We have this new system coming in. There now appears to have been a substantive substantial discussion which has led to this second amendment, which is a kind of compromise form of how the board would be created. But when we look at the legislation itself, it doesn't tell us a great deal about how that's going to work in practice. So we're hovering around the same point, which is that everybody has an idea of how it could move forward, but we don't have a lot of the detail on what that would actually mean in practice.
That's helpful, thank you. And just finally to Jennifer, so we've heard about no detailed form. The previous panel talked about fragmentation. So in terms of this legislative process, do you have any views on that one?
Can you clarify, sorry,
yes,
what you mean by...
So in your view, a point of view on how the Scottish Government is approaching the detail of the board creation in the bill. Thank you.
So if I've understood correctly, the Scottish Government's position in the policy memorandum is that co-design and stakeholder engagement still needs to take place around the detail of the bill. Is that the point that you were...
Don't worry, we'll move on. I think okay. Back to you, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you. And we'll move to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. In the last panel, we were speaking to particularly Rosemary Agnew around the complaints process and the fact that it's not really been changed between the bill as introduced and the now proposed Stage 2 amendments. Could the panel give us a view on how we can improve the cluttered landscape of complaints processes and the inaccessibility of those processes for people who need support as a result of their experiences with social care? And I wonder if I could go to Jan first.
Thank you, Gillian. Absolutely. So the Commission has taken quite a keen interest as the bill has been amended at Stage 2 in respect of what has been proposed in terms of strengthening the complaints and redress procedures as identified through the bill. As I said earlier, without those effective complaints and redress procedures in place, the human rights which are referenced within the bill remain aspirational rather than something that can be applied in principle. At this stage, we believe that the bill could go further to explore how that may be brought into effect for more people. One of the first things and probably the most straightforward things to do in the face of the legislation at this stage could be to introduce the right to provide advocacy for individuals in receipt of social care who require that in order to access their rights. There is legislative precedent for putting that in the face of primary legislation in respect of the Social Security Scotland Act, which has that right baked into the legislation, and would provide some certainty, I think, thereafter in respect of the development of any more detailed regulations. It's important that, albeit that co-design is an important principle, a human rights-based approach to co-design of anything also requires legality, and there are principles within the human rights legal framework that would guide what an access to justice system should look like within a piece of legislation of this magnitude. So we believe that that's critical. In respect of the Charter, which will also outline the standards of care that individuals can expect to receive, we again believe that the legislation could be strengthened further by amendment at this stage to guide what the effect of the Charter would be within the face of the bill. At the moment, it becomes an aspirational Charter developed through mechanisms of co-design, which is not a bad thing in and of itself, but without any specific guidance on the face of the legislation, particularly at this framework stage, then that could be open to further challenges being experienced by individuals in respect of their rights to redress and remedy. So we do believe that the bill, as amended, could be strengthened even further going into Stage 2. And we'd be very happy to follow up with the committee with further detail in writing, if that'd be helpful.
Yeah, that would be really helpful. Just to go a wee bit further into that, obviously, the Charter of Rights and Responsibilities is there, and as you rightly said, we need to make sure that actually has some real effect. Who or which bodies do you think should have some of the responsibilities within that? And should those responsibilities be made explicit within the bill to help people see where those responsibilities flow and actually who it is that they should be going in and speaking to and demystifying some of that, those structures for those who are accessing social care.
I think certainly in respect of any system that's going to be usable, it has to be foreseeable, and therefore in respect of good lawmaking, all public bodies and all agencies that are likely to be impacted needs to be clear. And I think the point you're making is it can be such a complex web of remedy and routes to address remedy for individuals who are exhausted. And who need a system that works better for them. So whilst the Commission hasn't publicly yet committed to writing a position on that, I think it would be fair to say that the Commission would expect that consistency and predictability and identification of who those agencies should be. And again, that would be something that would be of value, I think, for the committee to explore further. And I think in respect of clarifying the effect of the Charter absolutely has to be co-designed not only with those individuals, but also with all of those public bodies and agencies involved. But the effect of the Charter, we do believe, does need to be solidified on the face of the primary legislation. And again, we go to the Social Security Scotland Act as the most recent example of where this has worked. And Section 19 of that Act does clarify that the effect of the Charter may be that a court or a tribunal in civil or criminal proceedings may take that Social Security Charter into account when determining any question arising in the proceedings to which the Charter is relevant. So actually, applying a similar principle in the face of this bill in respect to the National Care Service Charter would go some way in providing clarity for duty bearers and for the courts as required and how to give effect to that charter.
It's great, thank you. And we have heard from some that if social care was operating to the level that we wished it would, that there wasn't delayed discharge, that there weren't people waiting for assessment and things, the advocacy and information might not necessarily be needed. Can you, in your opinion, outline why that piece on advocacy, that right to advocacy, that right to information is so integral to making sure that people's rights to social care and rights to that support can actually be realised?
Yeah. One of the core principles, going back to the purpose of this bill, as outlined by Feely, was to ensure that a national care service be developed that had the rights, will and preferences, choice and control of every person who requires social care to be at its very heart. And therefore, for that to be directed by individuals need advocacy support through that. You need to not only understand what your rights are and where to go to advocate for those rights, you need to understand the eligibility criteria you're working with, you need to understand how your social care entitlements may have an impact on your social security entitlements, your rights to housing, your right to wish to work and participate and to be an active member of society. That's quite a complex system to navigate. And as I've already referenced, the people that we're speaking about here, in our experience at the Commission, are very often exhausted. And the Commission has published research separately around the challenges in accessing justice and economic, social and cultural rights. And we see that borne out by civil society actors. It's too much. It's a full-time job in many cases to advocate for your rights to social care. And you are right that if the National Care Service does what it intends to do over a longer period of time, working through all of the issues it needs to work through over many years, then that need for independent advocacy, you would hope, would reduce. And maybe that could be an indicator for a National Care Service Board to monitor over that period of time. But until that happens, then the need for independent advocacy, and it has to be independent, so not associated with the local actors, not associated with the people who are holding the purse strings in respect of making decisions at local authority level. It must be independent and have the rights of the individual at its very heart. That right would make such a difference to individuals navigating that web. And actually, being able to influence that nationally would give a National Care Service Board at national level and local level some insight into what's really happening in terms of delivery. So not only would it benefit individuals, but it enables systems level learning to take place as well.
That's great. Thanks, Kamina. That's all my questions.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to you. I have a couple of questions about the establishment of a National Social Work Advisor and an agency. It's proposed that the National Social Work Agency would be an executive agency closely aligned with the Scottish Government to deliver on government policy. Do you think this is the right way to proceed? In the previous panel and in last week's evidence, we talked about non-departmental government bodies versus establishment of a new agency. I'm just wondering about your thoughts on that.
So in our response, I don't think we would take a view on exactly what form a new body should take. I suppose we are still a little bit unclear. Whilst we welcome the fact that is now provision in the bill for the agency, I think we are still a little bit unclear as to how exactly, as proposed at the moment, that will fit into the existing organisational landscape, where there are a lot of other organisations that already have roles and different structures that are already in place. So I suppose it's not clear to us how creating a new further public body in that already cluttered landscape and putting that on a statutory footing alongside the separate National Care Service Board, how that's actually going to improve things for end users, that would be our concern.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if Isla wants to...
Probably don't have a lot to add to that, other than to say, I suppose, like a lot of the bill, there is an aspiration there. So one can see that actually if you create the role, then that in and of itself might actually start to provide some clarity around it, some leadership, some structure there that is currently not within the system. But again, at the moment, it's no more than that in the bill. There isn't much detail about exactly how it would be differentiated from other bodies, what kind of powers it would have, the level of scrutiny that there would be. So not to say that it wouldn't be a good thing, it could well be a good thing, but there's not really a lot of detail about it at the moment.
So a new agency could be like take the lead in further collaboration, co-design, co-working of other agencies. I'm thinking about earlier in this session, we spoke about how NHS, Ayrshire and Arran, it's one health board, but there's three local authorities, East Ayrshire, South Ayrshire, North Ayrshire, and they do stuff differently, and some of them are really performing well in terms of delayed discharge. So is there a role potentially for the National Social Work Agency to help look at what is working really, really well, and then helping support the dissemination of best practice with collaboration with other agencies?
I think certainly, I don't think I'm differing from any of the other responses in saying that there's certainly a potential for that. And I think a lot of people have welcomed the potential for that to actually give greater clarity, leadership, provide some consistency among not just within one board, but across boards. So there's certainly the potential there, but I suppose I'm echoing what Jennifer's saying in that at the moment, there isn't a great deal of clarity about exactly how that would sit amongst a number of other organisations, what kind of distinction there would be between the role that would create and, you know, what benefits that would give in a practical sense. So certainly potential there and potential to be something that's quite positive, but you would have to see what the detail was.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Kavira. Just want to turn to discussion around monitoring improvement and commissioning. Just want to ask in general what your overall assessment of the proposed stage two amendments are relating to monitoring improvement of a National Care Service. How might the proposals change existing practice, as you understand it to be undertaken? If you have any views on that.
Sorry. I'll come in first, if that's OK. So, in respect of the monitoring and improvement role of the National Care Service, and particularly through its accountability function, the board, it's not particularly clear about what that would look like, how that would be achieved. And nor is the accountability route for improvement.
From the Commission's perspective, it would be essential that human rights are embedded in the National Care Services Board functions in order that that is laid out in primary legislation and to set the parameters for what improvement looks like. Many of the issues, that the deep-rooted issues in social care that we've heard mention of in the session already, delayed discharge and so on and so forth, they have clear human rights basis, and a human rights framework does provide a route through that. And again, the Commission's given some thought to how the bill, as currently presented to us, could be amended further to strengthen that. And I'm sounding like a broken record, but going back to the Social Security Scotland mechanism there, there is clarity on the face of that legislation about the role of a National Oversight Board in providing that accountability, monitoring and improvement system. Required of Section 22, for example, requires an oversight board to prepare and submit to ministers and parliament a report containing assessment to the extent to which all or of the expectations set out in the Charter, or in this case the principles, are being fulfilled, and recommendations for improvement thereafter. Be more specific on the face of the bill about the purpose and function of a National Care Service Board around that national accountability, and therefore seeing that through into local accountability measures could be really, really valuable. And there's also the opportunity, again, to make explicit reference there to the requirements of CRPD, for example, in Article 19. So there's an opportunity to strengthen the face of the primary legislation here to enable that to go further. And very simply, by making explicit reference to the role of a National Care Service Board to the principles, that would be a very simple amendment to take forward. Okay. It isn't clear to us at present how the National Care Service Board would monitor budget setting. So one of the largest challenges for people who use social care and duty bearers alike is the resourcing and the prioritisation of resourcing. So taking a more human rights based approach to budget allocation, requiring a National Care Service Board to at least identify an annual budget allocation, what's intended to be spent and what, and a mid-year point of review of that, what has been spent, and then an end-year point of view of what has been achieved as a result. It's possible for a National Care Service Board to take on those monitoring and accountability roles, but it's not clear that that's the intent as yet on the face of the legislation, and therefore it is not clear to us how that then translates into commissioning practice. Okay. So quite a number of gaps there, but potential routes through it.
That's very helpful. Is there any other perspectives on that?
Probably echo a lot of what Jan has said there. It seems to us that on the information we have at the moment that quite a lot of the sort of detail around exactly how the monitoring and improvement function might work will be left to co-design after the bill's passed, and that will leave quite a bit of discretion potentially with the board as to how this will actually operate. So I suppose still a lack of clarity, a lot of discretion there. And also there are a lot of other bodies that already have monitoring and improvement functions in the social care sector. So again, we're not quite sure how what's been proposed here would fit into that wider landscape. Hmm. So it's a scope for more detail.
So the Law Society's written evidence did mention an already crowded legislative and organisational landscape in this space. Just wondered if you could maybe develop that point a bit in terms of the current structures for how strategic planning and ethical commissioning are supported, and is that something you have a sort of understanding of, and how this would move on? Would it create the circumstances for better organisational improvement as currently drafted?
I think that's not something I would want to commit the Law Society to a position on here and now, but I'd be very happy to take that away to our working group that have been looking at this bill and to write to the committee after the session.
That would be really helpful. Thank you. Just also wanted to bring up the point of ethical commissioning is explicitly on the face of the bill. The proposed amendments remove that explicit reference. Is that a concern that you, any of you, have seen that removed?
I think in terms of the intent behind the rationale for having ethical commissioning on the face of the bill was presumably to ensure that good decisions are made in respect of services which ultimately empower the right to independent living. So there is a concern in respect of the vacuum that creates. And the notion of leaving that to co-design, whilst welcome, actually, because you do need to do that, you need to have those conversations, but it has to be based on legality. And it would give us some degree of comfort if those principles were to be connected back into the purpose and function of the National Board, because that would ensure that those human rights and that human rights-based approach was guiding what success looks like, and therefore guides what ethical commissioning it does look like in practice. So that would be one route through to provide us some comfort about the impact of the loss of ethical commissioning on the face of the bill.
That's helpful. Okay, that's helpful. Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you. And Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. I am interested just to know a little bit about where you think we could advance Anne's Law. From what we hear from panels, the intent is there and people are doing it from sort of a policy perspective. They are making sure that that is happening, that important contact with family. I just wondered, in terms of legislation, do you feel that we need to wait on the National Care Service Bill, or do you believe that there is some legislation we could use or something that we could do to make sure that that was a right, rather than just, you know, potentially we can make it happen? Jan, do you want to come in?
Yep, I'm happy to come in on that. Yes, I think it's so two elements to this question. It's very good to see those requirements coming through in the National Care Service Bill, and whether that happens through a National Care Service Bill or a separate legislative measure, what's more important almost than redefining the rights in the face of legislation is defining what a redress mechanism would look like. So people already have the rights to family life and have the rights. Where the requirement for Anne's Law has come from is where those rights are not being met. And so simply restating those rights in the face of legislation won't necessarily achieve the policy intent unless a proper route of redress is also designed at the same time. And that could happen through a National Care Service route, or that could happen through an alternative legislative route.
Could you describe that just in a few sentences? I know it's complex, but no. What could we do now, do you think, that would make sure that that redress was given?
So I guess there would be two elements. One would be the routes to information and advocacy, so making sure that everyone is aware of their rights to family life and how to access that. And then the second element is quite straightforward. You know, if that isn't happening, who do you complain to? Is that an existing public body? Does that need to be a new duty of a new public body? Is that a requirement of a National Care Service? And what are the steps to go through, and who ultimately upholds a complaint, and what happens as a result? So it's just ensuring that those steps are baked into the system.
Practice. Lovely, thank you. Does anybody else want to come in? No?
Those seem like very practical suggestions.
Yeah, no, excellent. My last question, I suppose, is do any of the panel have... you know, we're at stage two, we've got stage two amendments from government. Would any of the panel prioritise any of that, or would suggest that there's anything at this stage in terms of this becoming legislation that's missing, or that the committee should be picking up on in terms of their scrutiny?
We wouldn't take a view on exactly how Anne's Law should be delivered in terms of sort of a legislative vehicle or anything like that. But it's important that there is obviously consistency and coherence across the statute book. And I know there are other reforms that are going on at the moment, potentially around human rights, around mental health and incapacity law, quite a lot of different reforms. And it's just making sure that, as well as the proposed National Care Service, that everything matches up and there's no inconsistency.
That's lovely. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Can I thank the panel for their evidence this morning? It's been a good contribution to the committee's scrutiny of the amendments at stage two. At our meeting next week, we will continue taking oral evidence on the Scottish Government's proposed stage two amendments to the National Care Service Scotland Bill with three further panels of witnesses. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.